Okay, this video is going to be part two of a chapter three, Network Protocols and Communications. So this is chapter three, part two of two for the NETACAD CCNA course one. And this is the version 5.1 material. And if you're looking for the 5.0 material, you can check on my YouTube channel. And I've got the videos for the earlier videos. Or you can leave a comment down below asking about those, and I'll post that link for you if you want to find the 5.0 material. Okay, well, let's get started here. We're going to finish up chapter two in this video, and we're going to be talking about data transfer in the network. So after we finish with this part, we should be able to have an understanding of encapsulation and decapsulation, you know, taking data and putting it together and then pulling it back apart on the other end and then transporting it across the network. And then we're also going to take a look at how localhost access local resources on a network. So we have a term called segmentation when we take a message, or we take information, but we're just going to call it a message in this case. And we send that through the network. Well, we segment that out. What happens is that message or that information gets broken down into smaller pieces of information so that it's easier. It doesn't take up as much bandwidth at one time. And so we can share network resources, because you usually are going to have multiple resources using a network, either a wire or wireless. And so they need to share that network. And to do that, just like with traffic, you have to have lanes and merging cars. And let's just say that we're going to send a message and it has 10 cars in that message. And so all 10 of those cars are not going to go all together. We're going to send those one at a time. And those cars or those messages are going to merge with other messages on the network. And so when those messages get sent, they get what we call segmented. And that's what we call a term, segmentation. We also have a term called multiplexing. And that's where we interleave the pieces as they go across the network, or what we call the media. Multiple communications are interleaved or interwoven together, giving each user a part of the bandwidth. And that's what I was talking about here, where those segments where you could have just one computer sending a message through the network, or you can have multiples going through. And so you can have on a network, if you're doing some type of wire sniffing or some kind of monitoring the network, you're going to see multiple messages from multiple units or multiple users or multiple nodes is another word to say for, in that case, going across the network. And they're all sharing that same network. And that's why we have the segmentation. And so as it goes across the network as segmentation, those multiple pieces are labeled for direction and reassembly. So each one of those packets or messages have source information on them. They have destination information on them. And they have identifying information. Just like if you were using a U.S. postal system, you would be sending let's just say, going back to the example of a card, we're going to send a letter to somebody or a card to somebody, and we go to mail that. We're going to have a sender and a receiver on the front of that. So when you receive that, you know who it's going to, and you know who it's coming from. And if you were sending multiple letters in order, let's say that you're going to send 10 letters, you would number those, and you would say, you know, this is 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, let's say that number 3 shows up first. Well, that's okay, because when 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and on through 10 show up, they may not show up in order. You may get 3 first, depending upon the route that it got there. And then it's going to reassemble it on the other end based upon that numbering system. So this node may send it, you know, 1, 2, 3. They may be interwoven with the other messages that are there, but that doesn't matter, because when it gets to the other end, the decapsulation process, it's going to be able to take those packets of information and read those and say, okay, I need to put these back together in order, and I need to take these and put those back together in order. So when we communicate the message, segmenting messages, it allows different conversations to be sent at the same time. It does increase the efficiency of the network communications, because we don't have to wait for one computer to send all of their messages and then the next one. So you're not having to sit there and wait, you know, maybe 30 seconds to a minute for another computer. And if you had, you know, say 20 or 30 computers on a network, you're not having to wait on one computer to send a big, large file through the network, because all of those can interchange or put their messages together and send those across there. But it does add complexity to the network. because you do have all of those different messages going through. So when you do any type of routing or type of sorting or with information on that, it is going to add complexity to the network. So what happens here with the protocol data units? And again, going back to the protocol that we talked about in the last video, the protocol sets how those packets or how those messages are going to be labeled, how they're going to be packaged together, and how they're going to be sent. So in the encapsulation process, we take our data. And so let's say that we're going to write an email. And so we write our data, we write the content of our email message, and then it gets segmented. So the segments say, okay, we're going to break down this message based upon these certain sizes of chunks of data, and it's going to break it up. It's going to break those up into data chunks. And then each one of those are then going to be put into a packet. There's going to be a frame put around it, which gives us our transport header. We're going to then add a network header onto that to say, how's it going to go across the network? And then we put a frame header on there that says, you know, how's it going to be sent? And then that is converted into ones and zeros or electrical pulses or light pulses or wireless radio waves. That's converted into the actual medium of being sent across, and that's at the bit level. So if you think about this in the OSI layer or the TCPI model, that's this layers of how this is all built and encapsulated down so that we can then send it out to the network. And here's another example of the encapsulation process. It's just broken down in a different way or visually in a different way. You would have your, these are terms that you're going to need to, I don't say memorize, but you're going to need to be very familiar with them on how they are, how they work. You've got your Ethernet frame, you've got your IP packet, Internet Protocol packet, you've got your TCP segment, and then you've got your user data. And this frame is what tells the network where it's going, you know, that's basic information. So that's how the routers or the devices. So if a web client sends, and we're just going to look at a simple network here. We're not going to go through any routing. We're not going to go through any internet or anything like that. The web client requests a web page and it goes across the network. And those ones and zeros are going to be built in here. They're going to be built in here. And so the Ethernet is going to say where it's coming from, where it's going to. It's going to say, here's my source. Here's my destination. And then it gets to the web server and it says, okay, I know this is coming from the web client. I know here's what they're, you know, here's the IP packet, IP address, or maybe the MAC address information. And then here's the data. They're requesting file one, or they're requesting page one. And then that web server sends it back and it does the process going back through. It encapsulates that information and sends it back. And then when the web client reads it and opens it up, it says, okay, here's all the information and here's my data. And now I can display that web page. And on the other end, this is the decapsulation. I always say decapsulation, but it's actually de-encapsulation is the correct term. So make sure that you get the correct term for exam purposes on that. But you'll hear me saying decapsulation just because it's easier to say. So that's what happens. The web server sends it back and the web page is displayed. Okay, well, let's take a look at data access. On a network address, we have to have, again, protocol set up. What we have to have is a standardization to be able to say when we send and receive, those devices can communicate with each other. So we have the physical, the data link, the network, the transport, and the upper layers. Again, you know, please do not throw, and then you get up to the sausage pizza way, but you've got, you know, for the OSI layer and for the TCP/IP layer as well. But the physical layer sets the timing and synchronization of the bits. That says, and there's timing. So it has to know over a certain amount of time, and it's like a clock, what they call a clock timer. And it says over a certain amount of time, I should have received X amount of bits. I should have received X amount of ones and zeros across there. And then based upon that time, it says, you know, I get a certain amount of bits, and it says, okay, this bit gets this, you know, I get enough ones and enough zeros. And it says, okay, I just got a new, this is a packet header, and this is packet information. And what follows is the data information or the data link, you know, the network information in them, and then following after that data. The data link covers the destination and source of physical addresses. And then the network is the destination and source logical network addresses. So you think about MAC addresses at this point. Think about switches. the logical network. Think about TCP/IP address, your IPv4 addresses, IPv6 addresses. Think about this as the layer three, if you're talking about the OSI model. And this is where your routers and managed switches are, switches that have routing functions on those. And then we get up into the transport. This is the destination and source process numbers. These are our ports. So if we're going to a secure web server, you know, you've got HTTPS, you know, port 443, or just a regular web page of port 80, that's going to be your port. And then you've got your encoded application data. This goes on up to the next level, and it says, okay, which program should be opening this, and then what is the actual data on there? Is this a is this a PowerPoint file, or is this a is this a web page that got served up, or is this just a regular file that got sent to me? So when we look at a layer three network address, when we talk about network addressing, PC1 here has an IPv4 address of 192.168.1.110, and it gets sent across, and this is just a subset of what's above here. So that IP packet gets sent, and inside that IP packet, this is a layer three IP packet. It's going to have the source. It says here, and here's where it's coming from, and I'm trying to get to this point right here. I'm trying to get to this IP address. So this router says, okay, I'm going to send this on because I don't know where 172.16 is, but I have another router here that may know where it is. And so it sends a packet out, and it says, okay, can you send this on? And router two says, okay, yeah, I can send this on. And or no, it can't. It doesn't know anything about it, or it may route that through. And hopefully it does, and you get the route through. And then this router says, hey, yeah, I do have that subnet, or I do have that local area net network of 172.16. And based upon the masking on that, it would say, okay, yeah, this is supposed to go here. So this router then sends it to the web server, or the destination. We're gonna and the destination, and then the web server says, okay, well, this PC requested a certain web page inside the data at the at the higher levels. The data said it's requesting web page alpha. So that web page alpha gets sent back, and it goes back through that process, and it says, okay, now these get reversed. The destination now becomes this number, and the source becomes this number. And then it just gets sent back through the exact same way. So when we're looking at data link addresses, we have a network address. That's your source IP and your destination IP address. It's responsible for delivering the packet from the original source to the destination. And it can be either on the same network or to a remote network. If it's on a remote network, you need some type of routing in place. You need some type of device that's going to be able to take that packet and say, okay, it needs to go somewhere. I don't necessarily know where that location is, but I know I have another router or on the other side of it, and I'm just going to jump back up here to the other screen. And it may not know exactly where it's going. For example, router one is not going to know about with the web server over here, but it is going to know that it needs to send it to router two to check that location, because router one says, I don't know where this is, where that is, but I'm going to send it on. Router two identifies and says, yeah, hey, yes, I need those packets because it is on an area that I know of. And then based upon those routing tables, it sends it along. And that's what the network address does. The data link address is the source and the destination. It's responsible for delivering the data link frame from one network interface to another, from a NIC card to another NIC card on the same network. So this is an example of a data link address. And I'll leave this here for a second, or you can pause the video. This is just a continuation. This is a smaller of it. So this is the data link. And you have your IP addresses. You have your layer two header, your layer three IP. So you have your layer, your L2 header, destination NIC, your source NIC. Think about MAC address, your hexadecimal MAC address. And then on top of that is your layer three. So a switch could send just using a layer two, but a router is going to use the layer three to send that through. Devices on the same network only use they don't use the layer three to route because they don't need to. So if I'm sending it from PC1 to PC2, or PC1 to the FTP server, that's on the same network. So they're actually going to use this lower level here to communicate, because they don't need to use the IP addresses. So that helps with speed a little bit. So if it's just going through the same switch, and it may send a signal that says, okay, PC1 says, I'm looking for FTP server. Here's the IP address, and here's the data link. and it sends it through and it says, okay, it went, got to the router, and the router's like, okay, well, I'm not going to send that through because I know it's on here on this network because I'm communicating with it. And I know that that IP address is local, so it won't send it through. But the web server over here, the FTP server, says, hey, that's for me. I'll accept all of those packets. It'll process the data and then send the information back. So devices on the same network, the role of the network layer address, and I'm not going to lecture through this. You can read that. You can pause the video and read these. What I am going to comment on is the source IP address, is IP address of the sending files, the destination IP address. So the network layer address uses the network portion of the IP address, and that's the leftmost part of the address. And then the role of the data link addresses, that's your source MAC address. That's that hexadecimal code. That's the data link. And so that would be what we consider a layer two. So when sending or receiving device on the same network as the sending device, the data link address is used. Now, when we're sending to a remote address or remote network, we use the layer three, or we use the higher, the IP packet header, the network layer. So local area network, we use data link. Remote or sending through somewhere else, for example, through a router, we would use the network layer or layer three if we're talking about OSI. I'm going to continually refer to OSI as the layering, so layer three. So we have this part of the packet. This information still gets read, but it doesn't really get used in the routing process. So when we get to the router here, and you know, these are on the same network, 1.10, and my edge router or my gateway is 1.1, and it's going to send the information there, and it's going to say, okay, I need to send this on, and it routes it on through, and then router two gets over on this side, and it says, okay, well, I know where 172.16.199 is because that's in my network. So it routes it then based upon the data link, but that this network information is still sent along with it. And then, of course, your data gets there, your request is served, and then it's sent back through. So on that remote network, the role of the network layer addresses, you have the source and destination IP addresses. They represent the host on the different networks. And then the data link addresses are the destination MAC addresses. So again, local, they use the data link, and that's the MAC addresses. Remote networks use the layer three or the IP addressing or the network layer addresses. Okay, well, this is a conclusion of chapter three, part two of the two-part video for chapter three. In summary here, we looked at, in total of both videos, we looked at how the rules are used to facilitate communication, how protocols are set, governing bodies. We looked at the roles of protocols and why we have those. We also looked in part two on how devices on a local area network access resources in a small network environment or a business network, and then how which layers, either a data link or network, is used in whether it's a local network or a remote network. Okay, well, this is the end of part two for chapter three. If this was helpful, go ahead and click like on the video down below. You can subscribe to my channel if you want to see updates. And if you have any questions, you can leave a comment below. And thank you for watching.